Listen to us. Was 2 weeks before Christmas. It's so good to see all of you sharing your morning with me. I am truly, truly, truly blessed. Y'all are so wonderful. It's Sunday at sunrise and we are blessed. Boy, we are blessed to have this time together, taking nothing for granted. On this positive thinking Sunday morning, taking absolutely nothing for granted. Y'all get ready. I'm gonna be opening up those microphones for those of you in the webinar with me. I appreciate you. Yes, indeed. Good morning, Ms. Howard. I need you. Good morning, Ms. Williams. Yes, indeed. Good morning, Sassy, Ms. Davis. Good morning. I'm coming after you. Yes, indeed. Ms. Lewis, I'm coming. Maria, yes, get ready. This morning is about the power of positive thinking. Yes, indeed. Let's get our Sunday at sunrise praise going. Thank you for sharing your Sunday at sunrise with me. It is December 13th, 2020. I'm J.B. Bryan, President and Chief Investment Officer of J.B. Bryan Financial Group, the home of AfroEconomics, a registered investment advisory firm, which has its core in God. Yes, indeed, the fifth principle. Out of 10 of AfroEconomics, our Black wealth matters. That fifth principle is God. Indeed. Yes, indeed. Thank you, Mr. Smith. Thank you. Thank you all so much for saying good morning. I want you to say good morning as well. I'm going to open up some microphones so that you can share some love with me this morning. It's about the power of positive thinking, and your feedback is positive. How are you, Mr. Lewis? How are you? How are you all doing this morning? Oh, Jenny Jones. Yes, indeed. Can I hear some voices, please?
Hello. Oh. Good morning.
Oh.
Good morning, everyone.
Yes.
Good morning. Hello.
Indeed. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm open up. This is my choir. So if your microphone is open, you're like my amen choir.
Right, amen.
The microphones that aren't open, I'm not sure. So I got to be 100% sure that you'll give me an amen. So I open up like somebody came in as a Galaxy A11. I'm not sure. but I know for sure. When I click Miss Jones, I click Miss Davis. When I click Mr. Lewis, I know for sure. When I click Miss Ramadan, like, you know, I want God to feel that way about me. I want him to know when I hit the day, he knows exactly what I'm bringing to the world. What? Oh, right?
Amen.
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 He needs to know when he clicks your microphone on what you're bringing to him. What you bring in, we need to know this. We need to, you know, it's okay. It's okay to be loud and proud about how much you love God, and he deserves to know what you bring. It's such a blessing. We can't be positive enough. I mean, in researching today's discussion about the power of a positive mind, all I found out was that your mind is everything.
Amen.
Your mind leads it. It leads it. Like, you know, we as a financial advisor, I have realized over the years that it's not about, you know, how much you make. It's not, because I've seen a lot of people make a whole lot of money and they don't have the power of positive thinking. They don't have their mind right. And the word says a fool and his money shall soon part. So when you look at it statistically, you know that it's not about how much you make, it's about how strong your mind is and what you do with it. And let's pray on this word, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That's all we got to do. Focus on those things. None of that says focus on your house, on your car, on your job, on spending things and impressing the people next door. No, it says things, what is true? What is true? What is true is that we should treat others the way we want to be treated. What is true is that we should work and serve others as if we're serving God. That's in the word. What is honorable? Doing the right thing, no matter who or if no one is watching. Being honorable, being right, being pure, being lovely. See, there was a Harvard research studied 70,000 women. Now, I'm going to trust that this is true for men, too. But the truth of the matter is, you know, I found this in a Time magazine article, and they said they studied 70,000 women over an 8-year period. And they said that the most optimistic group had an almost 30% lower risk of dying from several major causes of death compared with women in the least optimistic group. Isn't that something?
Yes.
And you know, we were talking about that, about how important will is. Haven't you seen that? Where people, I mean, I've seen like the motivational speaker, Tony Robbins, was talking about one time his father-in-law had a major illness. It was like probably, I think, a form of cancer or something like that. It was really bad. He was bad off. And they said that he was only going to live for like 6 months. So they sent him, he said, well, you know what? His wife said, come home. My dad's coming home with us because he's only got 6 months to live, but we're not going to tell him. So they focused on all that was true and honorable and right and pure and lovely. And he lived for years, years. He went to the hospital for something totally different. And the doctors came in and told him, and they weren't there. And they forgot to tell them, don't tell him what's on his chart because he doesn't have any idea. And the doctor said, oh my goodness, it's amazing that you've lived this long. You were supposed to be dead. Like blah, 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 blah. You have this, 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 and this. That man died within weeks.
Oh, get out.
That's how powerful our mind is. And when he began to focus on the world and what wasn't true and wasn't right, that, you know, you don't determine how long someone's going to live. The world doesn't determine. You know, his little science, he could have come in there and said, you are defying science. You're amazing. Look at what you're doing and keep on doing it and walk out the room.
Right.
Isn't that something? He could have just done that. But instead it was like, you're going to die. Should have been dead. It's something. Woo. They were so upset, he said. He said they were so upset. But the power in that negative experience is that we need to be very conscious of what we're focusing on. We need to be very conscious of what we're focusing on. We need to reap the benefits of having a happier, healthier, and more positive life. We really need to do that. Have you ever like been in a situation like this past week? Honestly, I have to be honest with you all. I had a life-changing experience in my life. Like all of a sudden, I realized how I had not had a successful relationship before Michael, my current fiance. I realized it.
And y'all, I see it.
You see, do you want to know why I never had a positive relationship before? Never had a successful relationship. Never. Wow. Like, because all I thought about was the negative. And don't let anything go wrong. All I can focus on is the negative. You know what I'm saying? Now, we can't control what people do, but I could have at least had a more positive relationship with myself. You know? Because if you, whatever we go through, if we only are focusing on the negative of the experience, then, you know, so immediately I was upset with Michael for the most shallow of reasons. Like it wasn't even anything to be upset about. Like, and then I just immediately went into this, I can't ever, that's why, it's not supposed to work. It's not gonna work. You're gonna, you know, immediately I felt my negative mind from all of the past negative experiences jump right on you. Have you ever had that happen? People can go to the doctor and the doctor say, you're sick. And they'll go, I knew it. You know, people say, I knew something was wrong. Have you ever had people say that? Like, you know, or they'll just be excited about something that's bad. But we have to change. But what I did was I started thinking about, like, in the midst of that, I began to pray. And I began to, everyone connected to me, we started praying. Because that's the answer. And I started praying to get that negativity out of my mind. And then I started thinking about how good my life is with him in it.
Yeah. Yes.
And how simple, you know what I'm saying? And how simple, that is amazing to me that I haven't, thank God, had to deal with anything that some people have had to deal with, like infidelity and things like that. I know that or abuse, none of that. I have a, thank God, a good man. But a client told me that even if her husband, now this is, you know what I'm saying? She said, even if her husband had an affair, there was no way that she was going to give up on her marriage. No way. She said, there was no way that she was going to allow the world. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
They have like
amazing.
They have like four kids together. And there's and I have seen people go through the same situation, you know, and they go, it's over, done, get out, can't take it. I don't want to. So the only difference is the mindset and what they feel that the will of God is for their life. Because if you, my first thing is that I've noticed in the study by this psychotherapist, Dana Lightman, she says that you have to reframe or divert when you're in a situation. So what the member is saying, who is deep in the word, is that if her husband makes a mistake and confesses to her and says, I was wrong, and you know, I did this and this and that, that she is going to forgive him. That is reframing the situation. Now, some of us may reframe it that, okay, you gonna have to go.
Sometimes these church folk can get you wrong on certain things, you know, to have you having a guilt trip, you know, the vows that you take, life and death, you going to hell if you divorce your husband.
Right.
So you got to be very careful who you
listen
to.
But yes, indeed, Ms. Williams. And see, what you're saying is you're divert. If you were in that situation, you would divert from that negative experience. She says she would refrain, both of which are healthy responses to a negative situation. And that is, see, because In Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22, it says that we are to be joyful. A joyful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. So the person that stays and is miserable and always complaining and talking negative, you know what I mean? They're messing up their heart and they're killing themselves. That is not reframing. That is, you know, killing yourself. But if a person says, I forgive him, he's asked for forgiveness and this, and they move on, they have a joyful heart. And that's good medicine. And to Ms. Williams, she said, no way. I'm a divert from this situation. I'm getting out. It ain't that important. You did me wrong. And she gets out and she has a joyful heart and she loves herself. And she looks at the opportunity, looks at it as an opportunity to focus on taking care of herself or focusing on her work or focusing on community service. Do you feel me on this, y'all?
Yeah, I do.
There's no like judging on, you know, this and that's right and that's wrong. No, both of them are healthy responses if you focus on God as you're going through it. Reframe or divert. But God's got to be the center of your life.
Well, JB, the main crux is, I guess, because she has four children. And I know, I mean, I've known several people.
They're grown,
that have
though.
Been,
They're grown.
Oh, no. Because I know most men stay into it. I just recently spoke with somebody, a friend of mine that's a home inspector. And he said he only stayed in the marriage because it was the wife that was supposedly doing the wrong stuff because of the children. But he said he will never do that again because the children were still miserable because they saw the parents.
Amen.
So because it's an individual situation.
Because they had not kept God at the center of that decision.
That's true.
You see what I'm saying? Because look, there was no joyful heart. They were toxic. They were sitting there being miserable. And the person may not, like, just because you allow a person, you know, to stay in your presence doesn't mean that they actually repented. See, if the person repented, like, you know, like I did, where you feel like, whoa, I was wrong. Like, you know, I'm not, whatever the situation is, you lie to somebody, you whatever, you repent, you correct the behavior, you know, then you can have a joyful heart and your house, your relationship, your business, you know, everything can be better.
Because well, JD, do you really think, I mean, I know that if he comes and says he repents, but do you think that woman will ever trust him again? That's the issue.
Because what, Ms. Howard? You don't trust him, you trust God. You trust whatever, right, Ms. Williams? You don't trust him, you trust God.
But that sometimes if a person admits that, if you don't see a change of behavior in them, then you know that he really didn't repent. Because I know things don't happen overnight, but gradually you should see a change. You know,
that's right.
I'm changing. I'm not going to cheat no more. You know, and he's proven himself. Where that man that stayed in that relationship, they probably lived like roommates.
That's right. And we're talking about it. And I know what you doing. You going over there with her. Get out the house. This and that. But we have to make sure also that whoever that person is, like, say it's a man and his wife is messing around on him, or his wife lies to him, or his wife has, you know, some really bad habit. She keeps spending all the money. Like, because women make a lot of mistakes too. We all make a lot of mistakes. Amen. What we sit there, we watch TV, Tyler Perry convinces us that we're perfect. These men are horrible. So it stops us from having the spirit of correcting, of self-correcting. So like we can make a life experience for a man so miserable that he's out there seeking, and the word speaks upon that. Don't make your man have to go out there seeking, you know, love from someone else. Like the, you know, and that doesn't make it right, but it's just that also we should take ownership that in some situations that if you're not accountable, you know, to your marriage, to your relationship, to your children, to your job, to whatever, you know what I mean? You have to be accountable to it. You don't think it's not going to give you love back. And you, I mean, people lose their job and they go, wow, you know, I don't know why they did that. I was only late 3 times. You know what I'm saying? And then, you know what? They're going to fire you. And then you have a relationship with somebody and you late all the time. And then you wonder why you hurt their feelings and they mad at you. You know what I mean? When you get in, like, you know, and that, so, you know, that we have to allow the Spirit, God, to change our way of thinking so that we can make the world a better place, our own. Because we can, you know, if a person makes a mistake and all we're focused on is they better change that behavior. They still doing that. You looking at the clock like, you know, they must be still, you know, whatever it is. They probably stopped by the casino because they 10 minutes late. I know what you did. Like the, you know, that we have to, you know, allow ourselves to not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of our own mind so that we may prove that the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. You know, so it's hard to not see a situation and see where what I can do to make it better. I was reading this one of those like word things, and I don't know why, because I know why now, because but I was very single when I read the article, and it was like the word of the day kind of thing, and it was telling a story about a husband and wife, and that the husband stopped coming home, and then the woman was like, what, I think I'm going to leave him because he's not coming home. And then, you know, the pastor or therapist or someone told her, well, this is what I want you to do. I want you to stop fussing. I want you to stop being mad. I want you to start making dinner. And I want you to start, like, you know, cleaning up and making a nice environment in your house. So he said, okay, well, I'm gone, like he usually did the next day. And she said, well, okay, all right, see you later, be safe. And then the next day, you know, so gradually over time, she said, well, aren't you gonna leave? Don't you have somewhere to go? And he said, nah, I don't have anywhere to go. So it was like, I had a client that was going through that where her husband was messing around. And I said, well, you know what? Well, she thought he was, she didn't know what was going on. I said, well, what we're going to do? And to this day, she says that I saved their marriage. And I said, well, what we're going to do is you just focus on you and stop being mean and stop trying to investigate and stop being Perry Mason. Just relax and make your home the best that it can be. And then we see, because once you know that you've done your 110, you know, then after that, even if it's over, you know you did your best. You know you came correct. You know, you know what I'm saying? That you gave it. Yeah. It wasn't you. See, because then the Spirit will change your way of thinking. You won't feel guilty. You won't be bitter. You won't be mad. And soon they'll be coming to you like, I don't know what I did. Because, you know, very easily, you focus on God. It's going to be very hard. I don't care how nice her body is for her to take your man. Because God is powerful, more powerful than what the word has. But if, you know what I'm saying? Now, the world is hard, though. And I was looking at a picture yesterday, and this brother posted, he's about 70. And then he posted a picture of a 70-year-old woman, and she had on a bathing suit, and she was like all sexy and showing herself. And I started typing. And I said, girl, you ain't got nothing to say. And then I didn't say nothing, but I said to myself, dear God, please, at 70, do not let me be out there showing myself like that. I had to pray to God. That was the lesson in it. You know, because I wanted to say to the man, because, you know, Miss Williams, you 70, you got a nice body. But thank God, thank God, you don't have to show yourself like that.
Well, JB, how does she look? No, I'm just
looked
curious.
Great. She really? Looked great.
Wow.
She looked great. But I'm going to tell you one thing. She would have looked even better in an elegant dress.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? In a nice pantsuit. You know what I'm saying? And in a nice little short little dress. Or something. She didn't have to have her underwear on.
Oh,
I don't understand. It was like, you know, and everything. I mean, is it really? And then Michael said, well, maybe she went through a breakup and she looking for a man. I said, well, I said, but then what's she going to get?
That's
she going
right.
to get another man that's only wants her at 70 for her body?
Mm-hmm.
How can I compete at 70 with my body? I don't care. You 70, you still 70. It don't look like somebody trying hard. Like just, she
I'm
can
still
try
trying
hard.
To hide what I have, and I'm not even 70.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know what I'm saying? And I
it's funny.
I mean, but you know, 70 trying hard, we're gonna do all right. But 20 trying hard, still gonna do better. So why are you going to compete on a level that you know what I'm saying? You, but you can't take my God away. God will make you, you know what I'm saying? God will make
right.
you the most powerful woman, and they won't even know why they love you. They won't even know. They'll just be like, I don't know. Like, she's 70 years old, and I just can't stop calling her, spending time with her. And it's not about the naked picture. And early in life, we realize, you know, that the power of God and the positivity that he brings in our life, that's what attracts people. And you're attracting men, women, little kids, young kids, you know what I'm saying? Like, everybody wants to be around you.
See, that's it.
Because you focus on the
that's
good.
It. That's
mm-hmm.
it.
Focus that's on the good. Yeah, but because it's way past. And I've heard Marianne Williamson, she's a writer, write on this, that as we mature, it's way past sexuality.
Mm-hmm.
Grown
mm-hmm.
women bring spirituality. Mm-hmm. Spirituality. That's something that a person that ain't been through what we've been through cannot bring even to the bedroom. They ain't got it yet.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
But yeah. she's not there yet. She probably never will be.
Amen.
She's
Amen.
Attracting what she wants to attract.
Amen. So, Amen. And there's men sharing,
you know
sharing,
what? You know what,
sharing
Jay?
Their little picture. That's so sad.
You know what, Jay? She's in her lane.
Yes, indeed. You're right. Look, you're right. She ain't waking up at no Sunday or sunrise.
That's right. She's in her lane.
That's why I didn't make a word.
That's right. Absolutely.
Because to the end of time, there are going to be some men who mm-hmm. want that. You know what I'm saying? So don't worry about
it. There's someone for her.
That's right. There's a
cold. She's in her lane.
That's right.
But
I'm going to tell you.
But
I'm going to tell you, most likely, a 70-year-old man that you would want to waste any time with or spend time with, not waste time. Because it'd be a waste of time to spend time with a 70-year-old man who's looking at people's bodies. That has not learned, you know, it's bigger than that. It's like, she's attractive, but I want a woman that really has some depth to her.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Amen. He's a who knows, yes, look, who true. Knows how to set a table and put a fork and a knife down and a spoon. Goodness. So tell him, Jenny, who understands what romance really is. So focus on the good. Good, you know, just focus in the Proverbs 16:24. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing
like
to the bones.
Oh, now you're preaching, girl.
Amen. Amen. Man, make a, you know, that's attractive, right? Make a practice of speaking encouraging words to yourself. And then, you know, I can guarantee that you're going to notice the difference in yourself and in the people that you attract to your life.
Amen.
You know, I remember I had neighbors across the street and they were, there was a white couple and they would go, honey, baby. And I promised that, you know, and I can say that, You know what I mean? That is the way I speak. I mean, I have to be very upset. You know what I'm saying? And but following the word has taught me, be slow to anger and quick to forgive. And you know, but it's so easy to be different. But when you say, like, this is the words that I speak, if you are saying, and you're like, baby, how are you going to be fussing at somebody that you call baby?
No, you can do it, because I was in the home of my friend Shirley Caesar and the bishop, and they had a little argument, and everything was honey and baby in their argument. I thought it was the cutest thing.
Exactly. Honey? Honey?
And Shirley was saying, well, honey, and the bishop was saying, baby.
You heard what I said.
And it was honey and baby.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Yes, indeed. If you know, speak life into everything that we do, even to each other. But it is amazing, you know, how we give up on each other so quickly. No, we need to be more positive to each other, to even to our female friends. You know, my daughter was telling me about her female friend that's lighter skinned than her. Said to her that light-skinned girls have an advantage, you know, over brown-skinned girls. And my daughter is beautiful brown. And I said, well, she's lost because she's black and light-skinned, and she'll never be light enough, because what she's really saying is she wants to be white. She ain't never gonna, she ain't gonna never be white. And my daughter said, is that it? And I said, yes, because anybody black who's lost like that, you know what I'm saying? Unfortunately, we got to talk to her parents. You know, just because everybody in her family is light skinned, that don't make it right. That's just, and I said, and also, Michael really leans towards dark skinned women. I think I'm the first light skinned woman that he see. And then she looked at him and he said, yeah, that's true. I was like, but look, I said, but I take it as a compliment because he sees the blackness in me. That's right. But you know, you have to realize that there's always, you know what I mean? I was telling her that's negative. And why would, you know what I'm saying? Women think that just because it's woman to woman talk, that you have the right to say something negative like that. And you know that your friend, you know what I mean? You mm-hmm. First of all, you wrong. You lucky you talking to her. My daughter is so sweet. Oh my goodness. But I wouldn't it be funny if she grow up and get like me, get
she
older.
Is.
She like start she tearing them up.
Like you.
Exactly. Is. What are you talking about? You know? Darker the berry, sweeter the juice, girlfriend. You ever heard of that?
Amen.
Right? She would be, look, Ms. Williams, with your light skin self. Look, both.
I am not light skin. I am tan. Thank you.
Oh my God! I'm gonna turn on your video.
No, you're not. Exactly. I'm tan. I'm not light. No way. My sister is a little lighter than you are, but I'm brown. I was the black sheep of the family.
Oh my God!
Because I'm brown.
Y'all don't know black. I'm telling you, she's not. I'm gonna point her out in our member meeting. Y'all gonna be like, no, you are not black. But it's still, we're darker. Look, it's still, we got a little bit of sweetness in our berry, but that's a blessing. But it's just silly for women, you know what I mean, to be so pessimistic, and we have to stop that behavior. That is like, and then, you know, why is everything got to be based on anyway, what men find attractive? What about inside? What about, you know what I mean? I was telling my daughter, I was like, you know, y'all sitting there going to college, still talking about what men find attractive. Who cares, really? But you know, you don't want to come too strong with that. Like, but you know, the guys are looking way past just the complexion. They're, you know, I hope that they're, you will grow to be more intelligent than that. I was like, you focus on your studies and make sure that you are focusing on people for their character.
But JB, it's sad that in 2020, they have a slave mentality on the color thing. It is so sad that they have not broken that mold yet. That is
I thought we've gotten away from that.
Not. That's exactly what I thought.
But you know what? Let me tell you something. Because my husband was the complexion of JB, my husband did get places that darker men couldn't get. Mm. So actually, I saw it with my own eyes. Mm. He really did.
Mm. That is true.
You would say that.
But a lot of that, a lot of that is because of what Black people did to Black people.
Exactly.
Because Black people were honoring only Black people that look closer to white. Because white people, I believe, see Black people as Black people. We're all Black. You know what I mean? You're Black. But we started, and I was discussing this earlier this week about the lady who won the first Oscar, the first Black person to get an Oscar. Remember her? Yeah. Like Fannie McDaniel?
Yeah.
The NAACP said, stop choosing people her color.
Stop. But they put her down also because she was
that's
doing
what they said. They said the NAACP said stop picking Black people, Black color people.
Yes.
They said do light-skinned people.
Light-skinned people.
That's how Dorothy Dandridge and Lena Horne and all of that started happening. But it wasn't because of white people. Mm-hmm. That was Black, that was our organization.
But you know, the NAACP wasn't really found by Black people. It was that's why a lot of they don't really do like the Black power. They make
that's so true. Mm-hmm. That's so true. Especially now, they try to focus more on like poverty or urban issues or things like that. That's a very good point. You know what I mean? Of colored people. And the and when you try to express that to people that are members, they don't really get that. Like, you know, say they don't see it, but it's, you know what I mean? It's not. But that fact that has not been apologized for and addressed is something I feel that they should address. Like the Catholics did, you know, when they realized that, you know, they had a big part of why Jesus was killed. And they said, you know what I mean? They did a public apology for it. That, you know, that we should definitely, you know, have some sort of accountability that we have created that, you know what I mean, layer. And what we should be doing to make it different. I mean, and if you read that story about Hattie McDaniel, I mean, we took money out from her. Like her career was ruined.
Yes.
Because they said, don't use dark skinned people anymore.
Mm-hmm. I remember that.
She had to start doing radio and getting a fraction of the money.
But also our community, they was down on her because she was doing parts as maids.
Mm-hmm.
That had to be a stepping stone. We had to start somewhere.
Yeah. And but the fact is, it was the truth.
Yeah,
that was the truth.
That's true.
What would she have been in Gone with the Wind?
But a maid.
And like she said, I'd rather, and this is her quote,
that's
I'd
right.
rather play a maid than be one. A maid.
That's exactly
Amen.
Right.
So I'm like, go on, girl. Like that woman was strength. That woman was strength.
Yeah.
You know, and we're not giving, but that is, you know, that's why we still, like you said, we have to continue to move forward, continue to, every time we have an opportunity to change the mindset and make it more positive that Black is Black is Black is Black, no matter what shade it is, you know, you're Black, your commitment and acceptance of yourself and seeing the beauty in all of us, you know, is something that your life will be better by achieving. Anybody who doesn't see that, you know, consider themselves lost. You have given in to the world. You're done. Until you change that mindset to be more optimistic about the beauty of our Blackness, you know, you'll be lost.
And we have to realize sometimes somebody got to be the stepping stone. Somebody got to be the first. We may not agree with it, but somebody got to start somewhere. You know,
and historically, my father explained to me, because he was a president of several HBCUs, he said that people his color weren't allowed to be presidents of historically Black colleges, historically.
Right.
It was started with HBCUs had white presidents. And then eventually they said, well, you know what? This Negro was smart enough to do it, you know? And they started turning the schools over to Black people to run. Isn't that something? But they were light-skinned.
Light-skinned, right.
You can look at the wall on HBCUs, and you'll see light, 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 you know, and then mm-hmm. it'll start getting a little darker. That's us. We choose that. We vote. We're on the board. So so in James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, consider it a great joy, my brothers, whenever you experience various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. But endurance must do its complete work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. We're going to experience these trials. We're going to experience the rejection, but it makes you stronger, stronger. So even if, you know, okay, you got that break, you know, I mean, just think about it. And I'm not in any way putting anybody down, but Dorothy Dandridge, you know, it's generally accepted that she committed suicide. She didn't go through half of what Hattie went through publicly. But she didn't kill herself. Isn't that something? Because she had been tested, but her faith produced the endurance. And I guess she knew, you know what I mean? So that endurance completes your work to be mature and lacking nothing. So if we get in there and all you think about is what you look like, she had it, never had that weakness. She knew it was her talent. She ain't ever worry about trying to be anorexic and how skinny I gotta be, you know? She was like, I'm gonna do this is what I do. I do it well, be my best, you know? Complete, mature, lacking nothing. If not, you're gonna be 70 years old, all over Facebook with your little bikini on. A fourth point is, be grateful. This is about our positive mindset. We're grateful, we're accepting. You know, that how we interpret things, you know, will make all the difference in the world. You know, like write down good things that happened to you today. Like today, now I'm taking, Michael is driving me, my daughter, to take my mom to North Carolina because I want my mom to be at home. You know, I see it as an opportunity. Some people, you know what I mean? Were like, well, I don't know. I don't know if I have time to go. I don't know if I have time to drive. Every time I do something for my mom, I consider it, this could be the last time I do it. Yes. Every time I kiss my child, I say, this could be the last time I do it. This morning, when I hugged Michael, I almost cried. Because I knew this could be the last time I do it. The last time. Be safe. Be careful.
Yeah. You know, we take things like that for granted. I just remember the one Christmas. We always celebrated Christmas together. You know, it was just my sister and her family and my parents. And we would do it. Yeah. And then one year my mother said, well, Gwen's not coming over. She's having Christmas at her house. I was so upset.
Amen.
But you know, that was the last Christmas because that year, that summer, my mother died in May and my father died in June. Mm. And we had Christmas, but my sister did not come because she wanted Christmas. And I just couldn't understand it because I always thought they're older. This will all, you know, you don't That's know right. when it's going to be the last.
That's right. That's
Anytime
right.
there was something to get together, I would just go. You know,
that's right.
I wouldn't complain
that's right.
and say,
that's right.
Oh, they're going to be arguing. Hey, they drink too. I just go.
Amen. Good for you.
And I have fun.
Good for you.
And I leave because I ain't going to drink. But I, you know, that's what right. they do. That's what they do. I can't change them.
That's right. And then it's meant for you to be there. It's not meant for them to be there. Because if it's the last time, like I remember the night before my father passed, I said, I'm going up there because I didn't want to go and I didn't want to be around all the people. And I hadn't been up there for 2 weeks because I was going through this duress about my father's situation. on that particular night, God said, go to the hospital. And it was like 2 o'clock in the morning. I didn't want to see nobody, nothing. I was scared. I sneaked around the door. I was like, Lord, what if somebody's in there? And he was in there all by himself. Mm. And then a nurse was doing something, but you know me, I didn't have to speak to no family. I didn't have to do anything else. God, and I listened. What if I hadn't listened?
Right.
And I sat down and I said, God, I said, Dad, you have done it. You have fought a good fight. You've done everything that you could do. You are done this thing, Dad. Do what you got to do. The next morning, when I went in there, that lady said, your father has been going down. His heart rate has been going down ever since the moment you left this morning. You know, the lady was still on her shift by the time I came back because they were telling me that, you know, he's taking a turn, this and that. I knew all that already. So when they were like doing, the doctor was like, you know, your father's not going to make it through today, da, da, da. I knew God had already told me that already. And we had had our private conversation. It was amazing to me.
Yeah, that's a blessing.
You know? And oh my goodness, it was such a blessing. It was like, Dad was like, look, come here. I mean, and the whole time we would talk, sometimes I'd be talking to him during the 2 weeks apart. I would sit down on my bed and talk to Dad. And my mom would tell me when she talked to me, your dad's saying your name this morning. That was amazing. Mm-hmm. I said, yes, I was talking to him. But I wanted to be, so whatever, like whoever's not there is not supposed to be there.
That's what I say.
Who is there is supposed to be there. That's like with Jenny, when you talk about your last moments with your husband,
that's,
you know what I mean? That's, you were supposed to be, because some people I talk to, and as soon as they leave, the person passes.
Yep.
And they, because that's the way it was supposed to be.
That's right.
In John chapter 14, verse 27, it says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give it to you as the world does. Do not let your hearts be distressed or lacking in courage.
That's right.
That's why we keep going. That's why when you know discrimination and you know that, you know, I might not be treated fairly, but you keep going because it makes you strong. That's how you win the Oscar. That's how you get it. That's how you win the Oscar.
That's right.
And you know what? And if people knew best, they would want a piece of it. They would want a piece of the strength. Like, it, you know, sometimes when you're around, I'm with my white friends and they will say like, you know, oh, I, you know, something about like, they like your size or you look so good or something, something. And I go, if you woke up in the morning and you were my size, you would cry and scream. You would just cry. I said, but this is mine. This is mine. This is my, you know what I mean? God gave me this and I can handle it. He ain't giving you nothing that you can't handle. So you're already complaining about your size. So how can you say you like my size? You know what I'm saying? But it's because, you know, it's because this is for me and I look good in it. But you know me switching up and I wouldn't want to be you.
Exactly.
So we can, I am grateful for all that I have. Every bit of it, I will turn it into a positive. I thank God for my strength. A lot of people can't build as much muscle as I build, you know? So don't be upset. But instead, some people say, well, you know what? I wish I was skinnier. Wish it, instead of seeing, you know, that even genetically, Black women carry more muscle.
Yes.
Genetically. Yes. Look at the strength that we have. And we need to be fighting to keep it. Instead of, you know, I got to lose this weight. Well, what you losing? All weight's not equal. You losing your muscle, sis. Stay strong. Do it. Imagine if we, you know, that 70-year-old lady wanted to impress me. Do 10 push-ups. Do 10 push-ups. Do push-ups. Do 10 the way I do it. Do the way I do it. Toes, no knees. Come on, girl. You know what I'm saying? Show me that. Show me that. Show me, you know what I mean? Show me how you recover, how you go through things. Show me that. Like, you know what I'm saying? That's the strength. That's the strength of our aging process. So also keep positivity in your face. Write yourself messages and notes and attach it to anything that you'll look at each day. Like in my bathroom, I have my sticker, Black Wealth Matters. That's what I see first thing in the morning. That's it. Write it down. Whatever inspires you, you know, make sure that you focus that. Make sure that you are smiling and really feeling the smile. Mm-hmm. And don't let anybody, you know, take that away from you. And one of the most effective, according to an Oxford study in 2017, found that performing acts of kindness to other people for seven days straight, in this research, they found that it had a measurable positive effect on the well-being and positive social emotion of the people who did that. So if for 7 days you continue being your positive self and helping other people, you know, you will find that it's going to improve you emotionally, and I bet your health as well, as we know from that Harvard study that said you're less likely to have those chronic illnesses and diseases that take people out because of a positive attitude. So in Proverbs chapter 15, verses 13 through 15, a happy heart enlightens the face, but a sad heart reflects a broken spirit. A discerning mind seeks knowledge, but the mouth of fools feeds on stupidity. The entire life of the afflicted seems disastrous, but a good heart feasts continuously. Right? Feasts right. Continuously, just because of their good heart. Their good heart. A sad heart reflects a broken spirit. That's Proverbs chapter 15. That's nice. In Proverbs 11, we could just read the whole Proverbs, right? And get positive. A gracious woman retaineth honor. See, this is 70. This is what 70 looks like. A gracious woman retaineth honor, and strong men retain riches. And our gracious women do both. A merciful man doeth good to his own soul. But he that is cruel troubleth his own flesh. The poor part is a lot of people are cruel, but they don't even know they're cruel. They don't even know that they're being wrong.
You know, JB, Solomon, you know, did, I guess, most of the Proverbs.
Yes.
And I was just curious why he was doing those Proverbs, which has a lot of wisdom. But he still had a lot of foolishness in him, you know, and something I always think about, is it something because of Black men, genitalia, dealing with, this is a little bit offline, dealing with Solomon, because you'll hear some people quote, some men that are doing unrighteous things, they'll quote, well, Solomon, he was in the Bible, and he had like, what, 700 princesses and concubines. And, yeah, why
do you see like stuff? But so, you see that as wrong,
what, having all those women?
Yes,
I think so. For that, yeah, I think it's definitely wrong. I understand it was in biblical times and whatever, but if you are a Black man, and which Solomon was, and he could handle 300 wives, what, and
exactly,
and concubines, then, mm-hmm.
But because Solomon was so wealthy that even when they adjusted for inflation and moving forward based on the assets mm-hmm. that they had, mm-hmm. they still don't have anybody today who was equally right. as wealthy as him.
Right.
So back then, they wouldn't let women work. They couldn't have property. They couldn't, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So he was doing appropriately because of his wealth for that particular time, because he was basically housing women.
But yeah, he was taking care of them.
But mm-hmm. when you're a concubine, you're doing something else. Okay, it's not just being taken care of. If you're a wife, you're doing something else. So yeah. What I'm saying to you, a lot of Black men look at that and they try to say, yeah. "Oh, I'm okay."
But he ain't that rich.
Yeah, but But they look at a black man as being able to do, you know, the sexual thing, and they'll actually look at Solomon and say,
yeah,
oh, that's why black men could perform or whatever. If this man could take care of, what, 300 wives and 700 concubines and princesses, boy, you know, he's a stud or whatever.
But there's no recording of that. He was actually like having sex with these people.
Right.
I think
he used them more like for entertainment. They're probably servants. They were probably, you know, but the men need to realize if they have that mind that, you know, yes, but during that time, and there was a lot of wars and things like that, that women really needed to be protected. So the, so that was, you know what I mean? Like, I mean, we're talking about the one that time, like women's faces were covered and, you know, everything. So they weren't going around like being sexy and solid, you know, look at me, like, cause they couldn't. They had to like cover themselves. So it was probably from relationships. How would he meet these people? It would be like somebody's cousin or somebody's, you know, their mom and then the daughter and then the whatever. I don't know. But it was a totally different time. And for any person to think that that relates to them having a whole bunch of affairs is like, you know, lost.
Well, it was stated that that was part of his foolishness, though. So I'm just saying.
But I would have to see, you know, we need to look at that word, who called Solomon a fool, because he's considered one of the most the most wise people.
Yes, right.
Yes. I always wonder about in Proverbs 31, the woman and the description and all of the things he talked about the woman. He was talking to his sons from what I've read. Like he was saying, this is what you should look for in a woman. Well, I always felt like that's kind of hard, Solomon, because you can say that because you have several. he said, but you want all of this out of one woman, right? But then, you know, but I just felt that was interesting that, you know, was he telling his sons about all of their wives, you know, and are we being fair to ourselves when we say, you know, you're Proverbs 31 woman, but you're not really making all your clothes. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You're not really like, you're not really doing all of those things. Mm-hmm. Like, are you underachieving? You know, to think like how rich he already was and his sons are, and they still wanted a woman that was producing, you know, bringing money into the house, basically doing work. So, you know, that was interesting. Like we have had as women a heavy toll, even in those times, even when your man had all that, look, all of that gold, all of that property, all of that stuff. And he still want the woman to be productive. Like, so if we work a little bit, I guess we shouldn't feel bad that, you know, I guess because a lot of women like Phil, well, I still have to work and I have to work. I guess men should refer to Proverbs 31 and say, look, Solomon was a lot richer than me. And he said his women should be going to the market and making the clothes. Look, you making me buy clothes. You ain't sewing my clothes. So but it is, I guess it could go either way.
But you know, you have to realize, look, I was married. It was hard for that man to have one woman. You know, he was not sleeping with all those women.
I know.
I don't know. You never know.
If I was his wife,
he had so many wives.
He probably would sleep with me one time in my lifetime.
Right? Mm-hmm. Would all of those?
One time.
You wouldn't see him till next year sometime.
No. Once in my lifetime.
But he had the strength of God in him, so who knows?
No, honey, he was a man. Don't fool yourself.
Let me tell you something. A concubine is just not the name concubine. A concubine does stuff, okay? I'm going to leave it alone.
I don't know, but you can't say that and say I'm going to leave it alone. What do you mean?
Yeah, explain yourself.
Come on.
We're all inquiring minds, what can I know? The scripture says
concubine, and a concubine is not just someone that's just being taken care of without having sexual intercourse.
Oh, yeah.
That's what a concubine is.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Oh, and you're saying like that we should say, oh, that's bad because he had them, you know, but.
Well, what you're looking at is the time that they were in. I understand the dispensation they were in, because if you look at that, men had several wives. You can go back to all of those biblical characters. They all had several wives. But it's biblical, but we're not practicing that kind of stuff now.
That's right.
Yes. No, baby girl. Yes. Yep. It is.
Oh, there are some people.
Well, I'm saying in certain religions.
My girlfriend's daughter's in it right now. Yes.
Wow.
I understand in certain religions, but I'm talking about.
Well, in our religion, you know, if we really followed the word, there are some Christians who do have multiple wives, definitely. Mm-hmm. More white Christians, you know, but they, like, remember that one, and they killed them, all of them, like the what was it called, David Courage or something like that, but I'm sure he's not the only ones,
but those are people drinking the Kool-Aid, JB. They're not normal.
My girlfriend, you're black just like me. Her daughter is into a relationship just like that.
I'm sorry, they're drinking Kool-Aid when they're like that.
Well, let's look at it from a positive point of view. They are happy. As long as he's happy. But look, I'm gonna tell you one thing that it says, even in the Quran, it says you can have up to four wives, but if you know that which is best, you will have one. So that, you know,
Farrakhan has several wives.
Yes, but it says if you know what's best, because it's easy. Mm-hmm. And I think he has like a main wife. I didn't know he had multiple.
He does, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But from a positive point of view, like, how much peace can we find in just like, wow, it is what it is, as long as they happy. Because look how much happier we could be. Like, say deep inside, now I'm just playing with you with this, Chris, but this is possible. What if deep inside you really want to be in a multiple woman relationship? Like, you really want this man, and he's a minister, and he believes in multiple wives, and he really wants you to be his wife, and you have put in your mind that's wrong. But the word didn't say that, but you have put that in your mind. So you are blocking yourself from a possible peace.
I don't know what word that is.
But the word doesn't say that you can't have multiple wives. Like, in the Bible, it doesn't say that.
But JB, we have to realize what dispensation people were in at one time. Okay, there's no way that I would want a husband. And it's interesting, if you look at the Bible and who wrote the Bible, and if you're reading the King James Version, which he was a little messed up himself because he had his own mother beheaded. So you have to look at it and take wisdom that God puts in you and the scriptures that you're reading, what all this entails.
Well, mostly, like you said, it's your relationship with God.
Right. And
you know what I mean? You deserve, like, if I'm gonna tell you the truth, if you were the fifth wife of a man and you were happy, I would not judge you, not one bit. And all it would do was bring me joy that Chris is happy and she's the fifth wife. You know what I mean? And it could be five after you. I just believe in a person, you know what I mean? I mean, because that helps me be more positive.
Well, some people think happy and within their own minds, and they don't realize, you know. I'm gonna be a little crass in here. I would not be happy for some man to put his dingle in another woman and then 10 hours later come and put his dingle in me. That would not make me happy. I'm gonna just be crass about it, because it's interesting to how the men can have all these wives, and it might be
I will support that too now, Chris. I will support that too. If you felt that God wanted you to have two husbands, I will support that too.
Right, but that's nowhere scripturally where women got 300 men concubines. That's interesting.
Well, that's only because of the economics behind it.
Exactly.
Y'all realize that. Exactly. That's only because of the economics.
Right, it's the economics.
Now, if you allow yourself to not be, you know what I mean, to not grow with God or to not develop your own personal relationship with God, then we're robbing ourselves. Like, and, you know, because if you go around, if we always look around for like other approval of what God is instructing us, we'll never get to do it. So if they really truly feel that this is what, and it's working and nobody's getting hurt, who are we to judge?
Well, like I said, each individual,
I can find it.
But people drink Kool-Aid in all different manners. So,
and if I looked in the word hard enough, I could probably find a way to justify you taking care of two men.
And you, so, if you look in the word hard enough, you'll find us, it's okay for us to be slave too. So
that's right. Exactly.
If you want to use any kind of wording or meaning to get your point across, you can go into the Bible and pull out whatever scripture you want.
That's right.
To satisfy your needs.
That's right.
But actually, don't make it right.
But actually, it's not about getting your point across. It's about what makes you happy. Because if you go in the Bible, and if brothers, if one was killed, it was the custom for the brother to go and marry his brother's wife and take care of her.
Amen.
Because it was about finance. It wasn't about, that's what it was about.
Amen. And I believe that that's the way it should be now. I believe that life would be a lot better if people looked out for each other. You know, and I remember going through that with my daughter's father, and when he left, and I said, if you don't want to lead this family, could you find another man for us? And he wasn't willing to do it. But I mean, to me, how selfish is that? You're leaving your family, but you don't want, you know what I mean? You don't want to help me because I don't want a date. I don't want, you know what I'm saying? This, you are my husband. So
that's not being taught, JBC.
Amen. Because he doesn't feel any sense of responsibility
to
me and his daughter, like having the leadership that we deserve. You know what I mean? And having a man, you know what I mean, that is providing and protecting and building. You know, I thank God that God brought me, you know what I mean, to a good man, to Michael. Mm-hmm. And I thank God for him. But I shouldn't have had to go through all these years and all of this, you know. You should, but
your daughter's grown now. You be honest. Okay, I'm not being disrespectful, but you don't really need a man now. You don't raise your daughter.
Amen.
That is for you now.
Amen. Now we have the relationship by choice. You know what I mean? But when we need it, like in the Bible, it's talking about when that woman, you know what I mean, the husband is gone, she couldn't have a job. She couldn't own property. You know what I mean? It was right for the brother. We look at things sexually, but that's not the way God wanted us to look at it. And I know that that's what my ex looked at it sexually. And I wasn't looking at it like that. I wasn't thinking about sexually. I was thinking about who wants to help build this going forward. You know what I'm saying? Sex was the farthest thing from my mind. I got a 4-week-old baby. You know?
But in the biblical days, you know, women were always under a man's covenant.
That's right.
So, but we don't, and we had that.
That's
because
right.
Because we always have, just like you mentioned earlier, JB, about war. Wars come and men die, and you still have a family.
Amen.
So that's why people would stay. You would have the extended family, and you would be under that covenant.
Amen.
And this is why we're having the problems that we're having today.
Amen.
Think about all these. I'm getting off the subject, but it's still on some. It's just like all these missing Black women.
Amen.
I'm from the South. Remember this. When we used to say, I'm going up the road, you just didn't go up the road. You went to someone.
Mm.
You went to cousin such
Amen.
And such. You went
Amen.
To aunt such
Amen.
And such.
Amen.
You went, so you
Amen.
Was under someone's covenant.
That's
so
right.
Somebody can give account for you.
That's
nowadays,
right.
We get up and go and nobody knows where
that's
you're
right.
at.
That's
and
right.
That's why we
Amen.
Got all these
look at it. How many single, hardworking women are participating now? And you know, for good women, y'all are good women. We are good women.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And the opportunities that our men miss out on. You know what I'm saying? Because we don't support one another. Like, I remember, you know, not, but I feel like a lot of times single women that are looked down on and looked at as a threat, instead of we have a responsibility to watch out for each other. Like, you know, if Miss Howard needs something, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I know that Michael can fix that and correct it. I should not be worried. I shouldn't be looking at, I'm not going to let him help her. You know what I'm saying? And that's the society that we live in. We both going the same direction. And I've been in this situation. And you can't give me a ride. And then I've gone to places, I'm trying to pick my stroller up. And there are four men, all with women, and not one woman can say, sweetie, help her.
Right.
I don't even want that man not going to help that woman. And that's women encourage him. Why you got to help
her?
Why you got to help her with the stroller? I remember going to an outside concert with my baby and I'm struggling. All these black men with women and all of them probably left their kids home. You know what I'm saying? So obviously I want my kid with me and I'm going to, they can't help. You can't help? Some sort of threat. I remember one time I went to something, I was the only single parent there, and all of them had couples, and all of the men looked at like, I wish I could help her, but I can't because my wife's going to get mad.
That you know why she got to get mad? Because that 70-year-old woman is trying to look at her man.
Exactly. That's so sick. That we can't, you know what I'm saying? We can't help each other.
Absolutely.
We have to stop. You know what I mean? We have to stop. Allow God. You can't stop man. We can't stop a man from doing anything. You know what I'm saying? We have to just allow, trust God. Trust God and allow God to use your man and help him become the best person that he can be. But you can be crippling him.
JB, there are so many women who are jealous.
Yes. And that's so sad.
I don't know how you get, you know, it's just whatever it is, you know, they're not even comfortable with their own sister and
that's
mother.
Right. That's right.
So that's right. Is just
that's
so
right.
Deep. You know, it ain't even about you, but it's just within their immediate family. They're even jealous of maybe their daughter.
God. It's, that's sick.
So the men are like that, to me, their women are like that.
That's right. They're beat down. Have you ever gone to the grocery store and you see a couple in there together and the man holds head down? What in the world?
Wait a minute.
What in the world should a black man have to hold his head down for?
Wait a minute.
You know what I'm saying? If you're coming and you're smiling and you're gonna speak to both of them and he go right down.
Wait a minute. You guys know how old I am now. I'm like, why should you be acting like that? I'm a senior. You're younger than me, woman. Why are you going to let me that over me with your man? I'm almost old enough to be your husband,
because
mama.
Because you shine and you walked out the house and you checked yourself and you look like you care. You know what I'm saying? And maybe she doesn't. You know what I'm saying? And maybe you look like you would say honey instead of calling him an ugly name. You know what I'm saying? So
insecure.
You know what I'm saying? But that ain't your problem. You know
they're insecure women.
She needs to
wait a minute. I want to say so bad. Lady, I have gloves older than your husband.
Well, I wouldn't. You do not need to bring insult, or you need to, I want you to change that mind, because I hear you say stuff like that a lot. And you need to change your mind. I know, and I find myself, you know, doing that sometimes. I'll think about like our age difference with me and Michael. And I told myself this morning when focusing on positive thinking, I said, I'm not going to do that anymore. You know, I'll think like, when I'm this age, you'll be this age. When I'm this age, you'll be this age. Lord, I'll be blessed to just get there. You know what I'm saying? Just get there. And for him to get there, people die every day. You thinking about 20 years from now?
Amen.
You better value this moment. You know what I'm saying? Don't you put yourself down ever again because somebody's younger, because that does not mean that they're healthier. I meet a lot of people younger than me that can't do what I do. Cannot do what I do. You know what I'm saying? They can't do it.
Right.
It takes a lot, you know what I mean? Your mental strength, your physical strength, you know what I mean? And the way I've seen you walk in stilettos, girl, please. No. Stop. Mm-mm. But we gotta get this positive mindset. It has to become a part of us and allow ourselves to shine. What are you thinking as you walk into the room? What is going through your mind? What are you thinking? Think positively. What are you thinking when you see the person over there miserable? You know, they're not mad at you. They're miserable.
That's
right. Isn't that true? They're sitting over there looking all angry. Like, why are they looking at me like that? They don't have anything to do with you. They don't know you. Sometimes I call places and they're mean. And I go to the person. I go, I don't know what happened, but I wasn't there. Please, please be kind, please be kind to me. You know, they mad. Blah, 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 blah. I'm just trying to make sure my client's taken care of. You know, so here we go. It's so sad. It's just sad. But so we realize it's so much easier to be negative. But like I said, no matter what's going on, like Proverbs chapter 12, verse 25 says, anxiety weighs down the heart of a man, but a good word cheers up. Cheers it up. Cheer it up. Anxiety weighs down the heart of a man. You know, let's have strong, strong relationships, supportive relationships, right? Be grateful. Be grateful. And then a final thought that I have I wanted to share with. A gracious woman retaineth honor, and strong men retain riches. And a merciful man doeth good to his own soul, but he that is cruel troubleth his own stress, his own flesh. So let's remember that. And in Psalms chapter 19, verse 14, in a closing prayer, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And in Romans chapter 8, verse 26, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Amen.
Amen.
So good.
Can I say something?
Please.
I love you guys.
Amen.
I get so much joy out of being with you.
Amen. That's so
good. Just like you in my home.
Amen.
I thank God and I praise God for
Amen.
You. Most of all, Jay.
Amen.
I love you.
I love you.
I put you in my life.
Amen. Yes, he is.
I'm a whole